medical self-help is an emergency measure to be used only in cases of sudden or extraordinary misfortune. If people require medical care in the course of normal, everyday living, they should always be treated by a doctor. However, when disaster strikes, you may not be able to obtain trained medical aid in time. There are many forms of disaster. They can happen to you and your family at any moment. This film is one of a series on medical self-help. Its purpose is to teach you what to do in an emergency situation when there is no doctor.
This is a dead man. He died a few minutes ago from injuries received in a disaster. He was not the only victim. Many people were injured, some seriously, some not so seriously. Each was given emergency medical aid at the disaster area and then transported to this shelter. This child was severely burned. He may die. This woman has a fractured hip. She may die. This man's leg is broken in several places. He may die. This young man's chest was crushed, and some ribs are broken. But he too may die. And this woman was struck by flying glass. She has only flesh wounds, but she too may die. Any one of these persons may die, not from the initial injury, but from one of the most serious complications of any injury, shock. What is shock? Shock is not a condition necessarily caused by electricity. It is not a condition necessarily caused by sudden fright or violence. Shock is a word which doctors use specifically to describe a vital depression of the body resulting from the effect of injury or emotion on the nervous system. A drawing may help to explain the nature of shock. The normal function of the body depends upon an adequate supply of blood to all the organs and tissues. If the total volume of blood remains about constant, it is more or less evenly distributed to all the organs and tissues. Under certain conditions, however, blood may drain from the extremities and become concentrated in the vital organs. The loss of blood from the brain causes fainting. Fainting is a mild form of shock. It is a temporary condition and is self-correcting when a person faints and allows blood to flow back to the head. But the more severe forms of shock are not self-correcting. If the condition is prolonged, the heart may not be able to circulate the blood. When circulation is critically reduced for sufficient time, the vital organs begin to die. This is the vital depression that doctors mean when they use the word shock. Shock often follows serious injury. It is caused by one or more of several factors. Hemorrhage, either external or internal, produces shock by depleting the amount of blood available for normal circulation. In severe burns, shock is caused by loss of body fluids as well as blood. Pain contributes to shock by its effect on the nervous system, which automatically tends to reduce circulation of blood to the body extremities and divert it to the vital organs. Fear intensifies shock by acting in a similar manner. It may cause a seriously injured person to go into severe shock and death. Shock may develop immediately following injury, or it may be delayed by hours or even days. In any event, the signs of a person in shock are typical. The skin is pale and cool or clammy, due to the drainage of blood from the body surfaces. The eyes are vacant and dull. They may appear to be sunken into their sockets. Because the heart is beating faster than normal to maintain an adequate circulation, the pulse is rapid. Although rapid, the pulse is also very weak. In extreme shock, it may not be detectable due to the collapse of the blood vessels. The breathing is shallow and irregular, with an occasional sigh, which indicates air hunger. This is a sign of diminished oxygen supply to the tissues. The victim may be restless, apprehensive, or in extreme anxiety. His fear of dying or being crippled gravely contributes to the deepening of shock. When you recognize the signs of shock, you must act quickly to prevent it from becoming worse. Remember, uncontrolled shock is always fatal. The first countermeasure against shock is to keep the injured person lying flat on his back and to loosen any tight clothing. This helps to restore blood circulation to the head and chest, as well as lessen demands on the heart. If a person in shock has a head injury or extreme difficulty in breathing, the head and shoulders should be slightly elevated. This helps to control bleeding and to make breathing easier. Before doing this, make sure the victim does not have a neck or spinal injury. The second countermeasure against shock is to conserve body warmth. Insulate the victim against loss of body heat by putting a cover over her. But do not let her become overheated, for this would contribute to further loss of body fluids by sweating. Make her comfortable by loosening her clothing and reassure her that everything is being done for her safety. If shock appears to be deepening, or if there has been extensive blood loss or tissue damage, place the victim in extreme shock position by elevating the foot of the stretcher slightly. This is called the shock position and can be accomplished whether the casualty is lying on a stretcher or a bed, or even lying on slanting ground, in which case his head is placed downhill. Remember, pain and fear will contribute to shock. Handle the victim with extreme gentleness and assure him that he will soon be taken to a place of shelter. A person in shock should be transported to shelter as soon as possible. This helps convince him that he is being cared for and lessens his anxiety. Here, counter-shock measures must be continued. If severe shock persists, maintain the victim in this shock position. Keep the victim warm, but do not overheat him to the point of perspiring. Watch him for signs of nausea, and make sure the shock position does not cause any difficulty in breathing. Lost body fluids must be replaced as soon as possible. Let the victim sip a solution composed of 1 teaspoonful of salt and 1/2 teaspoonful of baking soda to 1/4 of water. If this is not available, give him plain water at room temperature. He should take 1/2 glass every 1/4 hour, sipping slowly. Give fluids only if the victim is conscious and does not have nausea. Never give alcohol. Nausea and vomiting commonly occur in prolonged or deep shock. This is a serious complication for 2 reasons. The victim may choke to death on his own vomit, and vomiting intensifies weakness and loss of body fluids. To prevent choking, the victim should be positioned face down. with his head turned to one side. Watch him closely to make sure vomit is not sucked back into his throat. The face-down position should be used whenever a person in shock is unconscious or even semi-conscious. Although the signs of shock are typical, its occurrence varies with different individuals, as well as the severity of their injuries. Elderly or debilitated people are especially susceptible to shock. It may follow even slight injury. For this reason, countermeasures against shock must be taken promptly. This is especially important in treating people with burns. Provide rest, give fluids frequently. Pain following injury may lead to the delayed onset of shock. Keep the pain victim flat on his back and give aspirin or similar pain relievers. Since shock may result from internal bleeding, keep injured persons inactive. Rest and light nourishment are essential to uneventful recovery. At a time of disaster, shock may develop in persons whose injuries are actually slight, but whose emotions of horror and fear and sensations of pain are greatly magnified by the events which have taken place. By recognizing this possibility and routinely taking countermeasures against shock, you may prevent its occurrence. It is easier to prevent shock than to treat it. You can do this by keeping an injured person lying down, relieved of extreme pain, protected against chilling, and given the vital support of comfort and nursing care. In providing emergency medical aid for the injured, remember three life-saving steps you must take promptly at the site of rescue. Restore breathing, control hemorrhage, and combat shock. Combating shock is not a single act. It is the continuous, careful handling of the injured person at all times, from the disaster pickup site, during transportation to the shelter, and throughout the critical hours or days that follow. In a disaster, more lives can be saved by the prevention or early treatment of shock than by any other single measure of emergency medical aid.